oh, in so many different ways, is not here with us anymore. Today, we're here to celebrate all the wonderful things and all the wonderful ways in which she touched us. Every one of us here is here because we knew my mom and we all loved her and she loved us. So thank you all for coming. And at this point, I'm going to hand it off to Ron.
I'm going to have to look at my notes. I can't remember the way Chris did. Again, I wanted to thank everyone for coming. They're here virtually. This morning, one of my old school friends sent me a poem, which I wanted to read first. It said, "Until we meet again, we think about you always. We talk about you still. You have never been forgotten and you never will. We hold you close with our hearts, and there you will remain. To walk and guide us through our lives until we meet again." And for me, first off, I want to thank John and Sherry for introducing us. Sherry intended Peg to meet someone else that night, but fate intervened.
I think it was you.
We hit it off immediately on our most eventful and successful first date. I considered myself a very confirmed bachelor at the time. How wrong I was, but I never looked back. I never really believed the impact she had. Now, over 41 years later, we both loved and appreciated so the family and friends that we developed. Her brothers and sisters became my brothers and sisters. My brothers and sister became hers. Our three boys and now grandkids, great-grandkids, and all the nieces and nephews all follow. I can't even imagine a different path. It's just what a journey it's been. We were joined from the beginning. So farewell to my beautiful Irish rose. You will live on through your way, touching everyone around you. Thanks.
Hello, everyone. I'm Martin, one of the twins. And I'm going to pull up my phone here because I jotted some notes and no one texts me right now because he'll distract me. So give me notes if I'm off base here. Well, start out by saying it's impossible to sum up any one person's life, but especially Peggy, who impacted all of her lives so deeply. So over the last week or so, I've been trying to think of what to say, and nothing really came to mind. So I just had a lot of memories, some of them silly or trivial, some of them profound. So I'm going to try to get through a few of them here. And, if I embarrass myself a little bit by crying, I think we're all going to feel it at the same time. So, I thought about how much she loved vitamin E. I don't know if anyone remembers that, but she would put it on everything. On her face, that scar got infected, but it was okay. She meant well, and her love of slot machines. I mean, right? We were turning it, we could all go up there and pull the lever. And gosh, I thought of her love of coffee. And I know someone's going to talk about her McDonald's tirades when she would go through there and demand fresh coffee in 1985 McDonald's, not 2020. Yeah, sorry, Chris is saying I'm getting too negative here, but you know, I did, I kept thinking of this coffee memory I have as a kid, because I grew up in this house and I was in the front room that faced the street and the driveway. And my mom worked in downtown LA. And every morning when I was in grade school, I would wake up just as the sun was coming up, and I would hear her boiling coffee in the kitchen and her heels as she went across the house. And so I would open up the blinds when I heard her go out to the driveway, and she would start up the van, and then sometimes she'd see me and blow me a kiss. And that's the memory that really keeps coming back. And, you know, it's that constant care and affection that Peggy always had for everyone but herself. She never understood at the end why so many people visited, why they sent cards. She's like, why is everyone worrying about little old me, you know? And so let me check my notes real quick. I was on a good roll there, but let's see. I mean, you know, as I grew up, she would always support me in any request or dream I had, whether it was to have blue hair. You know, she drove me right to the store. So this is a great idea, Martini. You should really dye your hair fluorescent blue. And she picked out the dye with me, helped me wash it into my scalp so it stained it for 6 months. And, you know, when I said I wanted to major in English in college, a real lucrative career. And she said, yeah, how can I help? How can I support you? When I moved across the country, it was the same thing. First question was, how can I help you? And that was just the way Peggy was. I know a lot of us here, she said that, how can I help? That was the first response. It wasn't judgment. It wasn't criticism. It was just, great, this is your dream. Let me help you. And she was always so concerned for her family, for her friends, for our friends, for Chris's friends, everyone who touched any of us, that, you know, they touched Peggy too. And I know she'd be wondering, why are you all wasting a beautiful Saturday talking about me? You know, that would be the last thing that she wanted us to do. But I know she's looking down on us from that big casino in the sky. And she's with her brothers. She's with Mona. She's with all of our family that have gone before us. And I know she's sending love. So I want to do a little cheers if you could pass me that. So if you have your Mai Tais and on Zoom, if you have anything, we'll raise it to Peggy. And we love you. We miss you. We wish you were still here, but we'll love you forever. To Mom. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Aileen, and I'm one of Peggy's many nieces and nephews on the Riley side. And I started something like more formal to read, and it just didn't feel right. So I wanted to take some notes. I just took some notes, and because, like Martin, stories kept just coming back to me and made me think of things. So when I think about the characteristics of Peggy that were the things I admired the most about her, the first was her welcoming nature. The minute you walked through her door, you were part of her. And I think about that in a lot of the friends of all three boys. Like when we would come visit, she would keep me up to date on what was going on in your lives. And I know she went to some of your weddings. I mean, those were such precious and cherished times to her. And I, my personal connection to that is that at my wedding, in a drunken haze, one of my former roommates changed his ticket to go back to Portland for a week later. and then woke up the next morning and was like, oh crap, now what am I going to do? I can't afford to stay anywhere. And so of course, Peg and Ron were like, sure, Garrett can stay here. And so this roommate of mine, who I love dearly, we're still friends, stayed in the living room for a week, and they didn't mind this guy, and he was welcomed in, and or if they minded, they never told us. But he's like, I've never met people who were so kind and so welcoming to me. And so that's one of the first things I think of. The second thing is her generosity. She was generous with her space, with this space. If there was ever something, she and Ron were like, sure, have it here. It was amazing. Generous with money. There was a time where she was so upset at the thought that we couldn't make it to a family event that she said, I'm going to buy the tickets and forward you the money, and you can pay me back when you pay me back. To her, it didn't matter. And being part of that day to this day still is a huge memory for me. But also generous in her time. My husband would never forgive me if I didn't tell you the story that a few years back, he blew out his knee at work. And he works in a middle school, and I work in a school. And at the time, we were working in different districts. And the doctor said he had to stay off his knee for like 3 weeks, I think. And we called Ron and Peg, and we're just kind of kvetching about it and talking about this. And I was getting up early and taking him all the way to his job, which was an hour away, and then coming back and doing my job, and then going and picking him up and bringing him back. And so we were just kind of bitching about it, you know, to Peg and Ron, and talking about life. And Peg goes, well, why don't I come up and take him to work every day? And I was like, we both kind of looked at each other like, what are you talking about? Why would you do that? That's crazy. And she said, I'm retired. What else am I going to do with my time? And so true to her word, she came up and every day woke her ass up early, stayed in our guest room in a really pretty tiny house for 3 weeks. She would drive him all the way to work. She would entertain herself for 6 or 8 hours, and then she would come back and pick him up and bring him home. I'm pretty sure she was at a casino a lot of those times. Sorry about that. I think that's when she became a frequent flyer at Spirit Mountain Casino in Grand Ronde, Oregon. But the fact that it didn't even register to her that was a big deal, that humility that she had in that service, that sense of service was who she was. For all of us nieces and nephews, Peggy was a safe place to go to. You could go to her, and I'm sure for many of you around here, you could go talk to her about something if it was bothering you or something you were struggling with, and you wouldn't get judgment. You wouldn't get, I don't want to break any parents' hearts in here, but sometimes you don't want to talk to your parents about things. You want to talk to someone who might be a little more impartial. She was always that person for us. And for many of us, I know that we could go and tell her we were struggling with something, and she would give us really wise, sage, not even advice, because I don't think that was her thing. I think it was just listening, and it was asking good questions to make us think and come to our own conclusions. That was a real, real gift of hers. And then humor. My gosh, that woman was wicked funny and wildly inappropriately funny, which was one of my favorite things about her. But her laughter was also contagious to me. And when she would start laughing, I would start laughing. And it just is impossible to keep a straight face around her. A couple of my cousins here have touched on the importance of family. I feel like all of the Rileys did that for us, and the Rileys Coles, the Rileys Cole. We lump them into Rileys. So many of them went before her that I know they're having this huge celebration right now. And they'd be, like they have said, upset. But the thing that so many of you instilled in us, and I'm looking at Sharon Catherine now, is how important family is. That we support each other and we love each other, even when you fight. When I married into my husband's family, I didn't understand it. They're a little bit, oh God, I hope your mom's not watching. shit, sorry, Loretta. They're a little more, we don't talk about stuff. Don't rock the boat, we don't talk about things. And I was like, I don't get that. I grew up with people who like fought about it, they fought it out, and then they hugged it out, and it was fine after. But you aired your stuff and you dealt with it, but you were always there. There was never a question. You might have times where you didn't talk for a while, but family was so important. Here. And all of those, yes, the Riley side, right? Yeah, okay. So there's that. And then finally, one of my personal favorites was Peggy's singing. And I don't know that if you didn't spend time where there was quiet times around here, you may not have known it or may not have seen it. But I used to love it when I was a kid, and I loved it even more as an adult. When she was like in the kitchen doing dishes, or she was doing just putzing around the house and house cleaning, she would sing. And she always thought she had not a good voice, because I'd go, oh gosh, I love listening to you sing. And she would go, oh God, I sound horrible. I'm not, you know, and she'd shake it off. But so I learned to never tell her that when I was listening, because I loved it. And I have, in my thinking in the last couple of weeks, I think that's one of the things I'm going to miss the most, is the singing. So I'm so happy and proud to have been one of her nieces and nephews. And I'm so grateful. Chris, you said that beautifully. I'm grateful for the time I had with her. And my personal belief is, you know, she's won the lottery now. She's finally won the big jackpot that she's been looking for forever. But we're left to kind of hold it together and remember her. And we're sad because we don't have her anymore. But I'm so grateful that I get to miss her. I'm so grateful that I was able to touch her and that she touched so many of us here. Thanks.
All righty. I thought this was a genius idea to be the caboose, and now everything's been taken. And in true twin form, Martin took my exact opening line, so I've decided I'm going to start a little bit different with dance. Just a
interpretive dance.
Exactly. Yeah, you can all just decide now. Sorry for everyone. Sorry, Zoom audience. That was videos right there. Mom would like dancing, so that's all right. I think first I just want to say that, you know, my mom had, I would have loved another decade of her meeting new grandkids, you know, new extended family, just that warmth around. But if you have to go, and we all do, the way she went was truly beautiful. I don't think you can ask for more than a constant revolving door of loved ones, friends, family coming in to just sit at your bedside and to go on your terms. And she went so peacefully, and it would be remiss going through these without a huge, irreparable debt of gratitude to Mary, my cousin right here. Took this act that we all have to go through and molded it into something absolutely beautiful. And my mom was so comfortable day in and day out. And everyone who knows my mom knows she got, you know, embarrassed easily, be like, oh no, don't worry about me. You know, she'd like do her little thing. And it was with Mary, it was always like, I can be 100% with you, because she had that trust. And like so much of the family has said, this family is truly something unique. This, like Chris was saying, in terms of like the one you're born into, the one you choose, it is incredible just to see the network that can form over a person's lifetime. And the ways that we come to rely on one another. And when you consider where Sherry and Kathy and all of them came from and the lives they were able to lead, it is remarkable. To me, that is, you started here and you're all astronauts in my mind. Like it's such a beautiful thing. And I'm just, you know, a lot of people, everyone who spoke, talked about my mom being so open, and everyone was welcome in the Peggy tent. There was no, your card was never revoked. You could mess up royally, and trust me, I think There are a lot of people here. A lot of guilty faces in the crowd, including you are always welcome back into the Peggy tent. And I think, you know, Eileen really touched on it. And I'm eyeballing her in the back here, but one of our friends, Sarah, one time it was asked to her, like, what do you love about your soon-to-be husband? And she said, well, he's a man who listens to understand rather than listens to respond. And if I could, it's one of my favorite phrases ever, but I can't think of somebody who more exemplified that than my mom. And it did not matter if you were asking for advice, a shoulder to cry on, whatever it was, that tent served everybody. And I'm just, it's one thing to have a parent that can do that directly for her children, but to have an army that comes to rely on that person is incredible. And I'm just so, so grateful to have a mom that had so many children and was just always upbeat. And I'm so glad Eileen talked about singing and dancing, because my mom, I will always think about her anytime I'm in the kitchen. And I remember when we were in elementary school, a little boy came over named Jonathan, who was one of our childhood friends. And we were all sitting at the dining room table right there. And my mom was in the kitchen. And she's like doing stuff, singing. And he goes, oh my God, what is it? And he's like, she's just singing in there. And he's like, well, yeah, it's a Tuesday, you know, like, I don't know. And, like, and that was just her all the time. And I will always think of her and that little buoyant. She would hate that I called a waddle, but it was kind of like one of these little numbers. And it's just always going to be there. She's such a great person. I'm going to consult my notes real quick just to make sure I didn't miss anything I really wanted to say. I think all I'm going to end on is just, you know, another one of my wonderful cousins, Katie, right here, there's been a video playing on loop, and I know our Zoom audience saw a version of it as well. But it ends with this quote that talks about, if you could see yourself through everyone else's eyes, you would realize what you mean to us. And, you know, it's like my dad mentioned, she never understood like why so many people cared about her, but it was because what she represented to all of us. And I will just love her forever and always know that that sunny disposition and that welcoming heart is not only something that you can lay back in and relax in when you're feeling stressed, and it's also just a call to pay it forward in the way my mom did, and to always just be grateful for your loved ones and everyone around us, and just this big, unorganized, beautiful, messy family. And with that, I love you, Mom. cheers to Peggy. I hope you finally hit that jackpot. And that was it. But with that, I didn't know if anybody, after saying all the fun we're having, if anybody else wanted to come up though and just say something. I don't think there needs to be like a pressure cooker, so to speak, that you like have to come up right away. But if anybody wanted to share any words about my mom, you are more than welcome. Okay, I see.
He said earlier, my wife said that you're the reason he was born.
Who's your wife?
Who are you?
My wife's the one in the hair over there.
No, I mean, I'm not a talker, so I'm not. But I introduced one. And then when Sherry said something like, well, I don't know if he's good enough for her, I stuck up for Ron, and now they're married. What happened? I did good.
I'd like to say a little something. I remember when Martin and Matt were young, along with and number.
that. And of course, there was an accident, and Matt cut his head on a piece of glass. They were playing a game, and the glass, you know, splattered and cut his head. And the first, we took him to the hospital, and everything was okay. But the first thing that Peggy said to me when she got home, when I told her what happened, she said to me, "Are you okay?" And it blew me away. Like, you know, I thought she would be really angry. But instead, she's worried about my welfare. So I thought that was beautiful.
Okay, Mr. Hibbert, my husband, Ron, I didn't hook you up with that other guy. I saw Ron's beautiful twinkling eyes, and I almost dropped John. So I want to make that. And I saw, also would like to say, my sister, she's 2 years older, and she was my mentor. And she was a right fighter. Everything you had to do right. She comes to my house and says, "How come? Why do you use this?" And I said, "Because I like it." "Well, you shouldn't be. You should be doing what I'm doing." "Well, can I do it anyway?" "No, this is better." So, but every time, my sister was a right fighter, and I was a little loosey goosey. I stepped out of the doing everything right, and sometimes I stepped in, excuse me, shit. Every time I did, I'd call her up and say, "Stepped in shit. I don't know what to do. I'm going to go to jail." And she goes, "Well, come on over. We'll, you know, let's have some lunch and we'll talk about it." And so we did. I'm blubbering over lunch. I paid for it. And she says, "Okay, tomorrow we're going to go to see Maricky, who was a lawyer friend." And I said, "I'm going to go to jail." She goes, well, "I'll tell him the story you told me and let's see." So she did. And I'm blubbering. And 20 minutes later, says, "Keep the money and go to Disneyland." So this is Peg. She, everything that I had hurt me or hurt my kids or just a bad day, she would talk it out. "So let's go to lunch, talk it out." I know she's up there beating the hell out of 313 with all my brothers, or dancing with my brother Jim that has a band. So I love her so.
That's good, baby. That's good.
I just want to tell you.
All right. I see no hands raised. Ooh, okay. Here we go.
Oh, okay. So I'm going to start crying like right now. Get it out of the way. So as some of you know, Peggy was my great aunt, my grandpa Jim Cole's sister, and they passed away 3 months apart. Now, I knew Peggy for a lot of years. I met her when I was probably 7 or younger than that. I just don't remember it. And my grandpa Jim, he always called Peggy his favorite sister. Sorry, guys. That was just a fact. It was just a joke that we made all the time. So, like I said, 3 months ago, my grandpa passed, and before he did, Peggy came down to our house, and we knew she was coming. What we didn't know was about 72 hours previous, we were going to have a flood. I mean, there was poop water everywhere, The drains were flooding and our bathroom was destroyed. The downstairs where my grandpa lived was an absolute hazmat area. It was crazy. The whole living room, there was bisqueen over half of it. The ceiling was gone. The floor was gone. Our couch was in the middle of the living room because it couldn't be against the wall anymore. And we told Peggy and Ron before they came, we're like, hey, if you guys don't want to come, like, we get it. There's big blowers going on. They're dehydrating everything, basically an industrial vacuum for the air. And we had demolishers every few days, and it was just loud and crazy and hectic. And my grandpa was, he said that the blower sounded like he was next to a creek. And I said, I don't know what creeks you've been to. Suckers are loud. Like, mm-mm. He was on the other side of his wall. But when he passed, we were really thankful that they had come so close to his passing so that he was able to see her, because he hadn't seen her in a couple of years. And I was there for my grandpa passing, and it was really hard, but it was really nice to be surrounded by so many people and to know that that's how Peggy went out. Made me so happy because they met so soon after he passed. And I know that wasn't the plan, but I was so thankful that they both had family everywhere and that they got to see each other when they got to where they were going. And I just know that they're up there singing together music from the 60s, because why not?
Elvis Presley.
Elvis Presley all day. Grandpa made sure I knew all those songs. But I remember Peggy as such a sweetheart, that she and Ron both just came into our house, half of it torn up. Everything that could have gone wrong did. And they couldn't care less. They were just happy to see Uncle Jim, and they were happy to see me and my mom and her husband Ryan. And it was so wonderful to see that act where they were just like, you know what? We have a place to sleep-ish. Is the ceiling gone? Yeah. But it's safe to sleep, so who cares? You know?
Peggy was trying to
like
cut out the ceiling on her side of the room. And then she made Ron switch.
Just in case something came out of the ceiling to get her. But that is probably one of my fondest memories of her, just knowing that she could care less where she was. She could care less what was going on with the ceiling or the walls or the floor or the big fans. All that she cared about was being with family. And that's how she left. Was surrounded by family. And for that, I am so thankful.
Hi. This is Andrew Lorusso. Hi, I'm Andrew, her number one grandson. I wasn't planning on coming up to say anything, so I don't really have anything prepared, but I'm gonna leave my sunglasses on so you can't see my eyes. My grandmother was always one of the biggest foundations of my support growing up. I know I wouldn't have seen a lot of my family, but she was always the one saying that I should come on trips like Montana and Hawaii, even when I was the biggest little asshole growing up. And nobody knows her forgiveness more than I do. She was always mad at me. But even when I was a hot-blooded, arrogant 18-year-old sailor, she still came to all my graduations, all my important events, and it meant a lot to me. I know when I was little, she always lamented that she couldn't be there as much as she was for my brother and sister. But I didn't even notice. I spent a lot of time here. I didn't even realize that I didn't get as much exposure to her as they did. Obviously, she was retired and they were just babies. I think I kind of always cultivated this idea that my grandmother was immortal. I was kind of in a unique situation where when I was in school, all my friends' parents were the same age as my grandparents. She was so young. And then watching her overcome other adversities like cancer before, I just thought, you know, she had under control. And I just never even thought about her passing. I'm just so glad she was able to go in peace. I know I talked to her not too long before, and she was more concerned with us than she was with her, and she was ready. So I appreciate everybody coming here, and I mean, she would have loved to have been at the party too.
All right, well, maybe here then we'll leave it to, okay, the man is would like to speak.
On Peg singing, I loved her singing voice, but more important than that to me, she was singing, I wasn't in trouble.
Perfect note, but yeah.
Hi, everyone called me Mimi, and I am Carolyn's daughter, and she was Peggy's first best friend. And I know she collected best friends everywhere she went.
I've grown up learning about Peggy's willingness to jump in and fix everything, even if it wasn't asked of her. She was always there to be a co-conspirator and a fixer. My mom said that she was the smartest girl in school and is credited for filling out her Social Security card and her DMV card and teaching her how to drive. So in her mind, she would not have done any of those things without Peggy. They would even push the Black Rambler down the hill to start it by popping the clutch. And I know a lot of the millennials don't know what that is. But at 50, I remember
the old,
that somehow.
Yes. Yeah.
I knew for every day of my life that I would love that woman always, and I had the gift of being able to love her every day of my life. And when I was about 12, I had a growth spurt. And Peggy comes over and she knocks on the door, and I answer the door and she says, "Oh my God, where did you get those boobs?" And then she said, "Oh, your dad." And from that moment on, she became not just my mom's friend, but one of my best friends too.
Seeing if there's any final takers with our few minutes, because otherwise we would just, you know, ask that you all socialize with one another as Peggy would have loved, and share memories and enjoy Mai Tais or anything you like in the tent. She's greeting everyone in the photo here, so we just want to thank everyone again from the bottom of our heart for coming. We've had so many people fly in, travel in, make arrangements during a very tough time in the world, and we're just so extremely grateful to all of you and everyone joining us via Zoom. We're so grateful to have a way just to get all of these people together and just express to our mom, our friend, our wife, our everything, just how much she meant to us. So thank you so much. Enjoy yourselves, and we love all of you. Thanks.
Someone told him the hair was messed up.
I don't know. They might have us muted. I don't know.
Martin, love Santa. I see you. Jesus, you look like your dad.
Good job, guys.
It's the eyes.
I wish I could be there, Martin. You and Matthew and Ron and Buddy, but well,
I don't know. Peggy. I don't know if you can hear. That's all I'm saying. He's not safe. He's muted. I wonder if he has the rest of us muted, though, is the question. I wonder if I can ask him if he's muted. Oh, he walked away. It makes no sense now. I wonder if he has everybody muted. Is that why?
forgive our feelings.
I don't know.
We can hear each other.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
He is muted, so I don't know if he can hear us or not. If he's close, he should be able to listen to us unless he muted.
Okay. Muted.